I want me some glory hole.
Oh, yeah. Hello, welcome to the Football Glory Hole Podcast. We can listen to Apple Podcasts, Google Podcasts, Spreaker, SoundCloud, YouTube, or on iHeartRadio. We thank HN every Glory Hole Seeker for tuning in this week. I am your host, Bo Cephas, and I'm joined as always here on the sports patio by my good buddy Longhorn. Longhorn, what's up, buddy?
All right. Woo, Bo Cephas, here we go. It is playoff weekend. I am fucking fired up and ready to go. We have three games on Saturday. We have three games on Sunday. Hey, Bo Cephas, the last time I had three on Saturday and three on Sunday, let's just say I spent that Monday on a penicillin IV drip. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. Glad to see my sexual tragedies are always a sense of amusement for you. And not only that, listen, quick PSA to the glory hole seekers out there. Viagra overdose is a real thing, people. Those little blue pills are not candy. They're not candy. And listen, I'm gonna actually quote a real quote from my doctor. One Viagra a day and the boner will stay. Okay, that's all you need. One a day, people. Now, whether you are here for the funny,
it's a quest for fun. I'm gonna have fun, and you're gonna have fun. We're all going to have so much fucking fun we'll need plastic surgery to remove our goddamn smiles. You'll be whistling symphony doo-dah out of your assholes.
Or you are here for the money.
Anybody tells you money's the root of all evil doesn't fucking have any. They say money can't buy happiness. Look at the fucking smile on my face. Ear to ear, baby.
You have come to the right place. Two questions for you people. Do you like football?
What a stupid question that is. What a stupid question. You ask a lot of stupid questions.
Oh, I'm sorry, Mr. President. I'll do better. Do you like money?
I'm a big fan of money. I like it. I use it. I have a little. I keep it in a jar on top of my refrigerator. I'd like to put more in that jar. That's where you come in.
That's right, Adam Center. That's exactly where we come in. And we have weekly, monthly, and yearly packages to fit your needs. Go to our website, thefootballgloryhole.com, and hit us up for those free picks, premium picks, and betting strategies so you can bet football the right way, the winning way, the football glory hole way. Y'all know the drill by now. We will make you laugh. Bo Cephas will make you cringe.
Holy Santa Claus shit.
But most of all, baby, we will make you a shit ton of money.
Woo! Woo!
Woo!
Ow!
Love that money!
Now, since we are that good and people do love us, we have an additional YouTube show in collaboration with 105.3 The Fan in Dallas called The Degenerate with world famous RJ Choppy.
Murray and against Zana, left side, swings this one, Holloway for three, and I set fire to the ray. Watched it pour as I touch your face.
Now, with all that business out of the way, Welcome to the world's number one football capping podcast. Bo Cephas, as always, right here on the sports patio, we got all five TVs glowing. We got the beer heavily flowing tonight, and right now it is everybody's unfortunate favorite part of the show. My friend, tell the people all about your horrible, fucking disgusting cowbear hip choice of the week.
Well, thank you very much, sir. Tonight I am drinking a Voodoo Ranger Higher Plain IPA.
Good Lord.
From New Belgium Brewery in Fort Collins, Colorado. Very good IPA. 3.5 out of 5 stars in the beer app. And it reminds me that every new year, we should all be challenging ourselves to find a higher plane of existence. Whether it be spiritually, emotionally, financially. And Longhorn, I know this sentiment hits home for you because, you know, your last quote-unquote special guy friend stopped coming around the patio, and you've been in an awful funk since then. So I'm just going to go ahead and remind you that there are plenty of other, you know, men in the sea or semen in the ocean or, you know, something like that. But regardless, just keep your pretty little head up. And that tall, dark, handsome stranger of your dreams is just around the corner, baby. I promise.
No. No, sir. I will not. I am not going to even acknowledge or indulge this homosexual innuendo discussion. I will not give it the light of day, sir. No.
Oh, my God. All right, boys, we're girls. We're going to get the podcast. We're going to give you some free picks. We're going over the good, the bad, the hard. You fucking kidding me? And we're going to go over all six. And yes, I said six wild card games in the air tonight. But right now, baby, we're going to make you some money, but we got to make some money first. And to do that, it's this week's sponsor. And this week's sponsor is betanysports.eu. I said bet. Hey! Sports.eu is the only place to go for online gambling. All sports, as the name suggests. They got poker. They got full casino games. They got the over or under how many handsome men Longhorn will have on the patio in the next 6 months. Take the over there, kid. They got reduced juice, minus 105 most situations, same day payouts. They welcome Bitcoin. God damn, it's over $35,000 a share. They have the widest selections of props, parlays, and teasers on the internet. People, go to betanysports.eu. Put in code word Glory Hill. You get a 35% sign up bonus today. What does that mean? It depends upon your $1,000. You get back $1,350. You take their free money with our picks. You're winning money on top of money on top of fucking money, baby. It's betanysports.eu. Code word Glory Hill. One more time. I said bet. Hey! Sports.eu. Code word Glory Hill.
And now it's time for the good.
Oh, that's good. That's good.
Well, that's just fucking great!
That's just fucking great!
The bad!
Is this bad?
Well, that's fucking not good.
And the are you fucking kidding me?
Are you fucking kidding me?
Are you fucking kidding me?
God damn it! Are you fucking with me?
All right, boys and girls, as always, we start with the good, and the good last week was Tommy fucking Brady there, kid. 43 years old he is now. He threw 40 touchdowns this year, almost one for every year that God's graced us with his presence. Second most in his career. Everyone needs to appreciate, honestly appreciate, what the fuck we're actually witnessing right now in the NFL, because boys and girls, you ain't gonna fucking get it again.
No. And you know, as a man in his early 40s as well, I would just like to I'm gonna go ahead and compare myself to Tom Brady here, if you don't mind. Give me some space. Mm-hmm. And use a line from the great Doc Holliday and say, nonsense, I'm in my prom.
Yeah, Tommy is in his prime and fucking
very much.
And now we're gonna move on with the bad, and the bad is that anyone doubted Tom Brady. Okay, you don't doubt the fucking goat until the goat is done. Longhorn, you and I had a buddy that texted us at the beginning of the year that not only would New England be better without Tom Brady and go to the playoffs, but that Tom Brady would fail miserably in Tampa Bay and not do shit without Bill Belichick. Well, everybody that had that sentiment, you can all sit down and be fucking witnesses to the greatness that is Tom fucking Brady.
Yeah, I mean, we talked about it on some of the very, very early podcasts this season. I mean, just to remind people that are just now new listeners, I am holding a golden ticket a la, you know, Willy Wonka and the Chocolate Factory. Tampa Bay plus 5,000 on a $50 bet to win the Super Bowl. Now, of course, I put this in before Brady went to Tampa, because I was, you know, proactive, and I signed up about four or five teams that he was on the list to go to, because guess what? Whatever team he goes to is an instant Super Bowl contender and instant great value, and it just so happens that although they're not the favorite and it is kind of a long shot for them to go, guess who I'm rooting for this weekend?
Yeah, I bet. And you know what? Looking forward, all they have to do really is go to Green Bay and win one game. That's really all they have to do.
Yeah.
Moving on to the are you fucking kidding me? And this week, that award goes to the North Carolina Tar Heels. So we had the North Carolina Tar Heels plus 10 versus the Texas A&M Aggies. UNC was up 20-17 going into the fourth quarter, so we're up by 13, starting the fourth, pretty good position, right? A&M ties the game, but then UNC goes down and takes the lead to go up 27-20. So now we're up by 17 points with 13 minutes left in the game.
Feels solid.
Aggies tie it with 10 minutes left, and then a bunch of nothing happens. And then finally, the Aggies break through, go ahead by 7 with 3 minutes and some change left in the game. We're safely up by 3. UNC's got to go for the touchdown. Aggies don't need to score anymore. We should be fine. Yep. UNC gets the ball back. They've got 3 timeouts, and this is the key. All three. Longhorn, how many do you have? You get 3 per half, right? All 3 timeouts.
Yeah.
They're only down by 7 with 3 minutes left. They're at 4th-and-1 at their own 34 with 3 minutes and 10 seconds left. They could easily punt it, try to play some defense, get the ball back, go for the win. No. They fucking go for it on their own 34 with 3 goddamn timeouts. They don't get it, and then the Aggies take over. And, of course, they score in the next play. They go up by 14, and that's how our bowl season, which we had a great bowl season, but that's how it fucking ends with the most brutal beat that maybe we've had all fucking year. God damn it.
Yeah, that was pretty bad. And, of course, Mac Brown, you know, they don't call me Longhorn for nothing. I mean, it's no bones about it. I am a Longhorn fan. And there was a famous, you know, soundbite that went around, and you can still find it. It was after an Oklahoma ass whooping that the Longhorns took to Bob Stoops. And old Mackie Brown came out there and at the podium said, well, I'd like to apologize to all Texas fans. And right now, I think he needs to apologize to all followers of the football glory hole because he fucked us right out of a guaranteed win there. And we will be accepting that apology at any time, Mr. Mac Brown.
All right, boys and girls, it's been 7 goddamn weeks of the NFL season, and now it's time for the playoffs. It is the Super NFL Wild Card Weekend, and it's time to find all those wins coming in the air tonight, baby! And Longhorn, we're going to start with the first game up on Saturday, and it is in Buffalo, where those Bills are now consensus 6-point home favorites versus those Indianapolis Colts.
Oh, baby. Okay, so, because we've already talked about these games, so, and there's only 6 of them, so of course we've been talking all week, but this is a game where I struggled the most with this handicap. It was a really tough handicap, and honestly, If I wanted Indy in this game, I could do a whole fucking write-up and make it sound convincing on Indy, and it would be convincing. However, I leaned my write-up towards Buffalo, fully understanding and knowing good goddamn well that I am on the public side here. And also, not only that, staring right at my power rankings and going against them. So Just let me put that out there. Everything I'm going to say goes against the power rankings, goes against what I would normally do in a regular season game for sure, 100%.
So how are you feeling about that right now then?
Well, you know, I'm feeling good to moderately good, somewhere in between those two things. But basically, you know, oh my God, I can't believe I'm going to say this. Sounds so square. I'm going to ride the hot hand of Josh. I couldn't even get through it. It sounded so stupid. Yeah. So Josh Allen is hot. He's playing. Look, I mean.
Yeah, I bet you think he's hot.
I mean, I'm more of a brunette guy, but, you know, whatever. So listen, Let's not forget, last year, let me play a little devil's advocate. Last year, he did shit the bed against Houston in the playoffs, and he looked like a quarterback that went to a, you know, like a Tim Tebow 7-on-7 camp instead of a, you know, a real 7-on-7 camp that teaches you to the forward pass.
So many gay innuendos here. Jesus.
Yeah, this is not – this handicap is not going the way I intended, but okay, let me get back on track. Bottom line, I'm going to lean to Buffalo here. I'm going to be on the square side. I just really feel that Buffalo is never going to take their foot off the gas, which that's what they've been doing. They much like Baltimore, this Buffalo offense just they love to fucking throttle people. And I don't know if it's because they've been, you know, not good for so long, and they know they have a good team finally again since the you know, Jim Kelly days, but. But they like to boat race people. Now, let me do a couple of concerns here that I have on my Buffalo pick, and then I'll throw it to you. Obviously, like I said, most of the money and most of the tickets are coming in on Buffalo, which puts me square on the public side, and I hate being on that side. And one little strange...
Hang on real quick. So let's set that out for the people. So most of the time when we say in the regular season, we differentiate money and ticket... Money being sharp, ticket being public. However, with only six games and when it gets to the playoffs, that kind of metric goes out the window, does it not? Because there's only six games.
Yeah, it gets a little blurry there. But with that said, they're both heavy on Buffalo here.
My point is, just because the money is coming in on Buffalo – that doesn't mean necessarily sharp. That can be sharp and public because there's so much public money coming in because it's only six games. That's my only point was just to tell people, like, hey, you know, because they've listened to, they know, oh, if the money's coming in, this is the way the sharps are leaning. That's not necessarily the case when it comes to the playoffs. There's just so much money bet and so little games is what I'm putting out there.
Yeah, and just to piggyback on that, I have heard that some of, at least from, some of the books that, for some reason, the sharp money is holding back a little bit this week, right now. Like, as of the time of this recording, there hasn't been that, you know, those big syndicates come in heavy like they normally would have already. So, you know, let's not put too much credence into that. But we know 100% which one of these teams down the list is going to be the public side and which one isn't. So I'm clearly going to be on the public side here. Now, this one little strange quirk stat that I'm going to throw at you, you know, and it wasn't my work, so I can't take credit for it, but it's true. Josh Allen is 31st QBR versus true Tampa 2 defenses this year. And that is the strangest, weirdest thing. That is happening. Now, I don't know if that's going to hold up here. It's a very small sample size, but we'll see. You know, it's worth mentioning for those who are, you know, feel like Indy is the side. I mean, you know, that's, we'll see how he, because, you know, you got to remember his division, they're all man-to-man type defenses. You know, New England kind of runs that hybrid, but they like a lot of man-to-man also. So, I don't know. It's just something to throw out there and be some information for the listeners, but I am going to be on the public side and I am going to lean Buffalo.
All right. So I'm going to heavily lean against you and I'm going to read my handicap on Indy. However, at the end of it, I'll go ahead and tell you, I've got the one thing that keeps me from just pounding the table and say, we have to take Indy. There is one major stat, kind of like you just did the Josh. Oh, that's a great fucking stat, but I've got one thing against Indy that's going to just stop me from pounding the table. However, deep dive in the stats here. Indy has only lost to one team all season who is not a top 10 rushing offense, DVOA. So, and that was Pittsburgh, who is the number one DVOA defense. Now, why is that important? Because Indy needs possession of the ball to stay in games more than a lot of other teams. Not because their defense is not great, because it is great, but it's because their offense is not explosive and they have to be efficient in the running game and stay on time when down in distance, and that takes more possessions during the game for them to generate those points. They are top 8 rushing percentage in the league. 45% of their plays are run plays. So, a team that is top 10 rushing the ball gives them trouble because it takes the ball away from them. Buffalo is 22nd DVOA in rushing, so advantage Indy there. Indy has also lost to teams with defenses who are top half in the league in the red zone as far as percentage of touchdowns given up, the lone exception being Tennessee, who they also beat, so you kind of got to throw that in the wash. Buffalo is 28th in the red zone D, so again, advantage Indianapolis. The Bills have lost to the 2nd, 4th, and 19th best DVOA offenses, and the 19th best that they lost to was the Hail Mary, so that's obviously the outlier. Indy is the 12th best, so again, advantage Indy. The only two teams that Buffalo has played that they and beaten that are better than Indy DVOA offense are the Rams in Week 3, which if you remember that, the Rams were going on their second straight West to East Coast game. They were already 2-0. And in that game, the Rams came out flat. They got down by 25 Longhorn, but they came all the way back to lead that game. And Buffalo scrambled to win by 3. The other game was Seattle. And in that game, Allen's grandmother had just passed away. He played very inspired, threw for over 400 yards, one of only two games that he did that the entire year, 3 touchdowns, no picks, and it still took Russell Wilson turned the ball over 3 times, including twice in the fourth quarter, for the Bills to barely win that game. So again, advantage Indy. Here is why I don't love it. Every single loss for Indy has come against a top 15 time of possession team. Because like I said, Indy needs the ball more than a lot of other teams. Buffalo is number 3 in the league in time of possession. So I do lean Indy. I love the number at 7. So if it gets back to
they're number 3. They're number 3 as in the one of the best in time of possession or one of the worst?
Yes, one of the best. One of the best.
Buffalo is?
Buffalo is.
Wow, okay.
So I love the number at 7. I personally grabbed it at 7. It's back down now to 6 because some money's coming in on Indy now. I would say wait. If you feel like me, wait on it some more. It should go back up to 7. The public, like Longhorn said, is all over Buffalo. Normally, we fade the public as always, which is what I'm doing. I already did. If it goes back up to 7, I would say grab it. If not, if you feel like my buddy, you should probably grab it now at the 6, but I do heavily lean Colts here.
Okay, and look, we're having fun here. We're having a little back and forth, and it's, you know, this isn't one that either one of us feel super, super strong about. So let me throw out a little stat that's on your side. Indy is one of the best teams at running the ball out of the 3 wide receiver set, and it just so happens that Buffalo is one of the worst teams at defending the run when offenses are in a 3 wide receiver set. So, you know, to your point, if they can, this feels like a game where you should end game, honestly. Like, if you don't like this game at all, because we are kind of on opposite sides and you just want to, and it's the first game of the playoffs, so, you know, if you want to kind of make it easy, don't blow your whole fucking, don't blow your whole weekend on tying this game into your parlays and your teasers right off the bat. If you want to wait to end game, whoever gets the lead here, I think whoever scores first, and specifically if they get a 10-point lead or more, I think it's toast. Do you not agree?
I think if Indy gets a 10-point lead, Buffalo still has a chance, which is because they're, I think, 5th in DVOA.
To win or cover?
Not to cover. You're probably right about that.
Yeah, so if Indy gets a 10-point lead, you're talking some of the
But if Buffalo gets a 10-point lead, Indy's in trouble. Indy's
big
in trouble.
Big trouble
there.
Yeah.
So, yeah, sure. If Indy gets up to 10-point lead and you bet Buffalo to start, you definitely want to fucking hedge at that point big time on Indy because Buffalo is the fifth. I think they're 5th best on passing. As bad as they are as rushing, as good as they are as passing on offense on DVOA. So they will catch back up. You know, that's what they do. But, man, Indy's defense is 12th best in the league overall. And they're basically 12th. I think it was 12th on passing and 8th on rushing. Like, they're just pretty solid all around. It's going to be hard for Buffalo to catch back up.
What scares and me cover about the that, six. What scares me about Indy's DVOA ranking is that you remember a lot of the beginning of the year they were one or two. So if you back half these two teams, you're going to see a much different DVOA ranking on both sides of the ball. So, you know, I think you can tell. I think the listeners can tell that we are. This is one of the toughest games on the board for us, and we're kind of tiptoeing.
Yeah, I think we're both on different sides here. All right, we're going to move on to Seattle, where they are now consensus 3.5-point home favorites versus those L.A. Rams.
All right, and before I even get going, because I did write this at least a day ago, who is, as of right now, the lean to start at quarterback for the Rams?
Sorry, one quick note. I forgot on the Buffalo game. Diggs and Beasley are now questionable. Just FYI. Beasley is going to be a game time decision. Diggs, I expect to go.
Yeah, Diggs is going to go. Beasley, we'll see.
Yeah. Right now, the line is moving towards Goff playing because Goff did practice today, so I would expect Goff to try and go.
Man. So, such an interesting little game of how this is how that's going to play with the line and is that, you know, is it a plus or a minus because of his thumb issues? It's going to be so interesting. This is the ugliest game on the board for me. This is one of my classic Longhorn first 1-10 wins type game. So, as soon as this game came out, I was all over the under. Just like you on the Buffalo game, I already put in on the under for this one. In the last six games, Seattle has played. The total average in those games is 37.5 points. And I believe the total on this one is sitting at about 42.5 at last check. And on top of that, the back half of this NFL season, Seattle's defense is seventh in DVOA defense. And a lot of it has to do with Jamal Adams getting inclimated, coming back from that injury, and of course the trade they made for Carlos Dunlap from Cincinnati. Now, also strangely, in that time, we all remember the talk at the beginning of the season was let Russell cook, and man, did he look like a fucking Gordon Gekko chef out there. Gordon Gekko's he's the chef, right? I don't want to get my pop culture mixed up, but he looked like every bit of the guy that could go out there and throw 50 touchdowns. Well, it just so happens about halfway through the season, right when their defense started playing well, Wilson turned into a turnover machine, one of the highest turnover rates over on the back half of the season of any quarterback. So obviously the coaches, they stopped letting him cook so much. They leaned heavily on that running game, which all explains the low totals, game totals that Seattle has had in this back half of the season. You know, when I put this under in, Wolford was making, you know, it was based on Wolford more than likely getting that first playoff start on the road, you know, and just if he does start, he's going to make mistakes. He's going to be nervous. He's just not going to play well. Now, if Goff is in there, I'm actually inclined to maybe double down on this under, because I've got to believe that over under will tick up throughout the week if he gets closer and closer to playing. As it gets closer and closer to game time, I got to believe the over under is going to go up at least another point, you know, maybe a point and a half. So I'm inclined to, I don't give a shit if he's playing or not. He's going to have a bum thumb, and they don't go over with a healthy thumb when these two play. So even if he does play, I'm almost inclined to double down on that under. On a force lane in this, on a side in this game, I would have to go to Seattle just based on the quarterback experience. But of course, that's thrown out the window if Goff is in there. So honestly, Bosevis, I'm torn on the side. I love the under. What do you got?
Yep, I love the under too. Already bet it at 43. It is at 42.5 currently. So it's one of my better bets of the week. Like you said, Seattle's offense is in shambles. They did let Russ cook, and since week 11, he has burnt everything in the goddamn kitchen. So if you take out the Jets game, which that was a total give-up game by the Jets, take out that game. Since week 11, they're averaging just under 21 points a game, which would put them right there with Denver, New England, Washington, and Philly. So some of the worst offenses in the entire fucking league. Now, I'm kind of opposite of you, though. I love the under with Wolford. Not because I think he's good, because I think if you watched the game last week, you saw Sean McVay being the genius that he is, call a very conservative game and making sure that he's not going to put that kid in position to make bad plays. The thing that concerns me, if Goff plays for the not that Goff's going to be great, because I don't think he's going to be great. No. The thing that concerns me if Goff plays is that McVay might have a little bit too much faith in him, and Goff might have a little bit too much faith in himself and try to make a throw that he really can't make or hold on to the ball half a second that he probably shouldn't, that he normally could.
Oh, yeah.
And with that injury, that could fuck us in a sack, fumble, interception, some shit like that. I have zero fear of that happening with Wolford, which is as dumb as that sounds. I have zero fear with a backup quarterback that I've never fucking heard of and I've seen him play one game. I have zero fear of him throwing a pick six. I have zero fear of him having a strip sack. Zero fear. So that's the only thing that scares me if Goff plays. It scares me on the under because of the – not that Goff's going to go out and put it 30. It's that maybe Goff fucks us with a defensive score. Now, on a forced lean, I have to lean with you on Seattle because even if Goff plays, he's going to be compromised. And so he's not going to be 100%. And if he doesn't, it's going to be Wolford. And it is going to be exactly what we saw last week with a conservative game plan from Sean McVay. And they're going to try to play the hell out of Seattle on defense, which they absolutely can, and they will. But it's Russell Wilson at home in the playoffs versus John Wolford. It's 3.5 points. So where I came down to in this, like, if you don't think the Rams could win the game, then you got to lay the points. Because they're not gonna hang within a field goal and not win, I don't think. So, but if you think the Rams can win, then take the 3.5. That's fine. But I just can't do it with John Wolford. But I'm torn on that, too. I think the under, absolutely, to our clients or anybody listening, it's got to be the play. Under, it's 42.5 now. It was 43 when I took it. Now, if you do think like I think, and it's not the spread, it's the Rams. The Rams are plus 155 on the money line. If I was going to play a side, that's exactly the bet that I would make. I would just take the Rams on the money line, fuck the points.
I got you.
All right, moving on. The nightcap on Saturday, the Tampa Brady Buccaneers -8 versus those Washington football people.
They are the skins of red, sir. You give them the respect that they deserve. And we're about to fight right here on this podcast because
woo!
Yeah, you're gonna see, this isn't like fake stuff. This is where, like, he's gonna call me stupid and I'm gonna look at him and I'm gonna say, okay, but in my mind I'm thinking, well, you're a fucking asshole and you're stupid. So that's what this is gonna be. I'm almost not even I almost don't even want to start this. I almost want to just, like, see what you have to say, but I'll just briefly go over. So to me, this is the absolute public side trap game of the week. you know, I've got all these things written down. Like, obviously everybody knows that Tampa is 0-4 at ATS at night games this year. Obviously everybody knows that. Tampa Bay.
Everybody knows that. That's a great fucking stat.
Okay, well, they're 0-4 ATS during the night games this year. And it was actually addressed by the coach, Arians, when they were having so many troubles with these night games. It was something they were, quote-unquote, had to look at to figure out what was going on, probably because old man Brady, as great as he is, he probably likes to be in bed at 8 o'clock. So
I mean, Matlock comes on at 7. What the fuck are we doing out here,
Matlock? Jesus Christ! How old are you? What?
I need to see my programs. Damn it!
What decade are we in, Matlock? Oh my God! Anyways, so also on top of that, Brady is also 0-4. Tampa Bay is 0-4 ATS versus top 10 DVOA defenses. Look. Let me just throw it to you because I know you're going to yell at me and cuss at me, and I'm gonna have to, like, put my microphone on mute for a little bit so I can so I can go cry in the corner. But Brady, bottom line, Brady versus a great pass rush. We saw this in the Super Bowls versus the New York Giants. And those New York Giants were not great on offense. Okay? They were not great on offense, but they rushed the passer and they held the points down. So, you know what? Throwing it to you. Yell at me. Go ahead.
All right. So, you did bring up some very good points, and I did poo-poo on your night ATS trend there, but I think it's a real trend, and I thought it was worth bringing up the podcast. I'm glad you did it, and I think everybody needs to understand it. It is a real thing. Anytime something happens like that and there's a reason behind it, right, then there it has to be real. Like, if it was just some, Tampa Bay's 0-4 on Thursday nights during September when it rains outside and the temperature's between 55 and 67, yeah. Not that kind of trend. It's a real trend. So I did poo-poo it when we were talking early in the week, but I think it's a real trend, and I'm glad you brought it up. Okay. Now, here's my handicap in this game. If you think about playoff games and how you handicap them, you have to think, first of all, to me, what are the chances that the underdog can win the game? It's always where I start. So there's almost zero chance that Washington can win this game. Being realistic, right, unless something terrible was to happen to Tampa Bay, and I don't put anything out there in the universe. So, and if you want stats to back that up, Tampa Bay has lost to the 2nd, 7th, 10th, and 25th DVOA offenses. Now, the 25th offense that they lost to was Chicago. That was a road night, again, on a short week. They outpossessed Chicago. They outgained Chicago by over 100 yards, and they lost by 1 point. So sometimes shit happens, right? Tom Brady forgot what down it was. Shit happens. Other than that, though, you do not beat this Tampa Bay team without a good offense, period. Now, trivia time for you, Longhorn. Who has the 32nd worst DVOA offense in the NFL?
Oh, God. This feels like a setup. Gee, let me guess, Bo Cephas. Could it be the Skins of Red?
Sir, you were always on the money. Now, follow up to that question. How many teams, again, are there in the NFL?
I don't like your little game. I don't. So I refuse to play it.
I think you know there's 32. So what you're basically telling me is Washington is the worst offense in all of professional football.
Prove it.
So now that you know that, the only question left is how bad is Tampa Bay going to beat them? Now, what should give you some pause and put you on my buddy's side against laying the 8 is that Tampa Bay, like you said, has not beat anyone with a better defense, DVO defense, than 13th. So that would put you on his side. However, when you factor in the fact that Washington has not beat anybody with a better defense than 15th all year, outside of that schedule loss of an exhausted and depleted Pittsburgh team, and the fact that Tampa Bay is 5th DVOA in defense, and on top of that, you got Ron Rivera talking about employing some sort of quarterback by committee, like rotation or situational quarterback play between a guy with one leg, which you watched Alex Smith play last week. Good God, is he awful. And the other one, who's named after some skunky European beer. Like, this game could get ugly really, really quick. And I understand that Tampa Bay does struggle with a pass rush, and Tom Brady always has. But my point in this game is, and the reason why it's my personal best bet of the week, is Tampa Bay minus the 8, is because Washington is not going to be able to score the football on Tampa Bay. And as hard as they make it, and I do believe that my buddy's correct, they're going to make it hard on Tom. It's a shitty field. It's always been a shitty field this time of the year. If you watch any Washington football people games for any amount of years, which they haven't played football this late in the year in a long time, but it doesn't matter. It's a shitty track. It's a slow track. It's going to slow Tampa down. It's going to make it difficult to do a lot of things they want to do. And Washington absolutely is the third best DVOA defense, and they are monsters up front. But Tampa Bay can score 20 points in this game and win this game 20-3, 20-7, and easily cover. And I think that's probably the way it's going to go. My personal best bet is Tampa Bay minus 8.
Yeah, which, you know, I've got this written down too. The under is a good play here. Couple quick things to counter that. Not that it's really a counter necessarily, but Tampa Bay is one of my favorite teaser legs on this slate. So I'm definitely not picking the skins of red to win this game or anything like that. And then the second point is going to be, this is the Saturday night game. So if it is a blowout about halfway in third quarter and you try to text me, Bocephus, I will be pissed drunk at the bar and I will not be responding to your text. Don't bother coming to look for me because I will stop watching the game and I'll be trying to cover something else, if you know what I mean.
Yeah, so love that. But one last thing in this game, it reminds me a lot of I was at the bar during the Oklahoma and Florida game, and a couple of our buddies were there with us, or with me, and they're asking me, you know, which way we wanted to bet this game, and I said, well, you know, it's one of those games where either Florida's going to win or Oklahoma's going to blow them out, so don't bother betting Florida in the cover. So what I will say on this, if you do think that the impossible of impossible can happen and that somehow that the Washington football people can hold Tom down, create some turnovers, and win the game, you just need to bet them on the money line. Don't worry about the points. They're plus 285. Because if you bet them on the points, it's $110 or $110 to win $100. If you bet them on the money line, it's $285. So you can win $285 or lose your $100, or you can bet $110 and lose your $100. And I think that's the way it's going to go. If you're going to go to the Washington football people's side, I would not fuck with the points. I'd go for the gusto and try to win the game outright. Otherwise, I think Tampa Bay is definitely the side to roll with.
You yelled at me a lot worse off the air, so I'm a little disappointed.
Well, I mean, that tends to happen. Anyway, we're moving on. The Baltimore Ravens come calling those Tennessee Titans in their 3.5-point road favorites.
Yep, and this is another game. Let's try to blow through these Sunday games a little quicker. This is another game where I was torn at the beginning of the week, and honestly, I think I was trying to search for reasons to take Baltimore here. If I had to be completely honest, I didn't find enough to do it. I just couldn't convince myself, I guess, that Baltimore was the right side. So I'm actually going to lean to the home dog here in the playoffs that has a track record of beating this Baltimore team and this particular quarterback. That number is just so juicy. Did you say it was 3.5 still?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, I mean, that scares me a little bit because they're kind of, in a regular season format, this would be like, hey, please come bet this 3.5. Please come take this 3.5. Could still be true here where they're begging to get that Tennessee money to even out the sides. Look, of all the teams, of all the underdogs on the card this week, Tennessee is the top seed for me of the dogs to win outright. So I have to take the points here. I can't go any other way. Like I said, it's got the history. I'm kind of scanning through my notes here as I'm reading. I could definitely see Baltimore winning this game, with a late meaningless touchdown for Tennessee, putting them in the, like, if Baltimore gets the lead, I could easily see Tennessee getting that back door within the 3.5. But if Baltimore falls behind, it's toast. So I guess bottom line, I'll throw it to you, is Baltimore can only win and cover one way, and that's getting the lead. Tennessee, they can win and cover falling behind or getting the lead. So I can only lean Tennessee here.
Yep. So last year we told you, and only we fucking told you right here, that yep, Tennessee was going to go to Baltimore, the 14-2 MVP Baltimore, and fucking beat them at home as 10-point dogs, and they goddamn did it. And guess what? This year's Raven team is 0.5 point worse than last year in our power rankings. But Tennessee's a full point worse than they were last year. Right. But here's why I like Tennessee. Baltimore's upgraded themselves since that loss to Tennessee in week 11 by 2 full points in our power rankings, while Tennessee has remained the same. So then the line was Baltimore -6 at home. So with 2-point upgrade, that should be Baltimore -8 now. So now you flip it to 2 points, make it 6. That's a 2.5-point delta, which is huge value in the NFL. So Baltimore should be the slam dunk. But here's where I disagree. To start with, the -6 Baltimore line was wrong. Tennessee outgained them by over 100 yards, and they won the game straight up. Turnovers and penalties were even, Nothing crazy happened, just straight up ass whooping by Tennessee. So now, at that time, the line should have been, by our power rankings, Baltimore minus two, which is why we gave you Tennessee that week, which would make this game a pick 'em once you flip the 2 points. But you give Baltimore the upgrade, so it's really Baltimore minus two, which flips the delta to minus 1.5 to Tennessee. But here's the last two factors why I think this gap's even bigger than that. It has me on Tennessee. During that run, the Ravens went to upgrade themselves 2 points in the playoffs. They played the Cows, Browns, Jags, Bengals. Only one playoff team in that run. Tennessee, during the same stretch, played the Colts, Browns, Jags, Lions, Pack, Texans, and stayed flat, which makes sense. They played three playoff teams and three non-playoff teams. So I think the upgrade on Baltimore is a little bit of fool's gold, or a lot of fool's gold, in our power rankings. The last thing is Tennessee, what they're worst at is rushing the passer. So naturally, all their losses this season have come to teams that are top 11 at protecting the quarterback. Well, Baltimore's 24th in the league at that. So Tennessee's biggest weakness is effectively neutralized by Baltimore's biggest weakness, thus canceling each other out. And to further expound upon that, Baltimore, every Baltimore loss this season has been to a team that is top 10 at protecting the quarterback. Tennessee is 10th best in the league at that, and that neutralizes that Baltimore pass rusher, which is their best feature as a defense. Last thing, the only team outside of the numbers for Baltimore that anything that I just gave you that they lost to was New England. And who do you think Coach Belichick talked to before they played Lamar? Probably his fucking old linebacker, Vrabel, who's now beaten Lamar twice and seems to have some sort of fundamental read on how to stop that offense. And in fact, the only two games, Longhorn, that Lamar has been kept under 4 yards per attempt while rushing when he had over 10 carries, so in other words, he did it a lot, were against Houston in Week 3 when they still had O'Brien and Romeo Cornell, both Coach Belichick guys, and then Tennessee. So I think the boys from New England have a rap on how to fucking hold down Lamar. So go Titans.
Yeah, I love that a lot.
All right, moving on. New Orleans minus 10 hosting the Chicago Bears.
Minus 10. Bo Cephas, quick question. Are we allowed to have a Hello Corner TV game in the playoffs? Is that allowed?
I think it's a Hello Water Break game in the time of all the fucking beer we'll be drinking over the fucking weekend for sure. God.
So
damn.
This is what, like the 3 o'clock game on
Sunday?
Oh,
yeah. This is time for fucking the beer snooze right here.
Yeah. Take you a little power nap. Sleep off that Saturday night, you know, Viagra overdose binge that you're going to be on. Maybe that's just me. I don't know. Whatever. Let's make this one quick on my side. Of course the fucking value is on Chicago, but I refuse to tell all you people to put your hard-earned money on Chicago. I refuse to put my hard-earned money on Chicago. Trubisky is absolutely going to shit his pants in this game, throw some terrible picks. Will it be enough to screw his team out of the cover? Probably. But I want no part of this game. Roquan Smith is out. He got hurt last week. So that defense, already fading defense, it has one less person to chase Kamara around on those little swing passes. The Bears pass rush, which is their strength, is going to be neutralized by one of the best pass blocking offensive lines in the league. This is an absolute hard pass for me. On a force lean, I would have to lean with the public, unfortunately, and take that huge number of New Orleans and lay the points. But if I was truly forced, I would put New Orleans in one of those teasers, although it's not one of the advantage teasers because you're going from 10.5 down to 4.5. So it's not your you know, prototypical advantage teaser. But that would be the only thing I would do here. I hate this game so fucking much.
Yep. I don't want any part of this game. I think you either lay the lumber or move on. Vegas is telling Chicago it's about a 20% chance to win this game. And what people need to remember with the playoffs, backdoor covers are hard to come by on big dogs because when they get down, and they get down significantly, and it's late in the game, the fight leaves them. They know their season's over. So, you know, and then other than the fluke win against Tampa Bay, which we covered earlier, Chicago has not beat a single winning team all season long. So I think it's either New Orleans or pass. And one last thing on that, you just brought up, what did you just bring up? The
Roquan?
No, it was, fuck. You just made a point I was going to reiterate now. I forgot what it was. Oh, the blow up. So the blow up factor. So generally in the wild card game, there's only four games. Usually two of them are blowouts and two of them are good games. We've got six. One to two are blowouts. The rest of them are good games. Now we have six. So you're going to guarantee yourself two blowouts. I think this is one of them. I think Tampa Bay is probably the other one, relatively.
Yeah.
And we'll get to the next one here in a second. But you're going to get two. You're going to get two out of six. You're going to be blowouts.
Oh,
I think this
sure.
is one of them. So, yeah, it's either New Orleans or pass for here for me.
All right,
moving on to the last game. And it's those Pittsburgh Steelers, and they're -6 at home versus your Cleveland Browns.
Not my Browns, sir. You still try to sneak that in every chance you get. Listen, I wish you could see my screen right now. I have Cleveland / Pittsburgh, and there is literally no words behind it because I don't need to write anything up on this. This was one of our favorite games of the week as soon as it came out. This is the, who are we kidding? This is everybody's favorite game of the week. I mean, we know the COVID situation with the coach. I don't want to sit here and regurgitate everything that everybody's hearing, you know, on the radio every day. So clearly, huge lean to Pittsburgh here. I don't think they've factored enough. I don't think they can factor enough of how much of a loss it is for your not only play caller, but your culture changer in Stefanski. There's no way to factor that in. You can't put this number high enough for me to not like Pittsburgh, you know, relatively speaking. So yeah, huge lean to Pittsburgh here. This will be one of those blowouts. It's a good thing it's Sunday night because, you know, if you're tired of watching football after these other five games and you just want to, like, you know, zone out at halftime when Pittsburgh's winning 20-3, this will be the game to do it. So, yeah, I've got nothing that will point me to Cleveland in this game. Baker, you know, it looked like he won the Super Bowl last week. He beat the Pittsburgh backups last week, and you thought that they won the Super Bowl. And I'm not going to bust his balls too much because that is a big deal because he's the first quarterback in like two decades to take Cleveland to the playoffs. So I'm not going to poo-poo on him too much, but he's about to face reality this week, and it ain't going to be pretty.
Yeah, he's the first Cleveland quarterback since the great Derek Anderson to lead them to the playoffs. So good job, Baker.
The great Derek Anderson.
How could we forget that guy? So here's what I will tell you that you've not heard anywhere else on the radio or any fucking where else except right here on fucking FGH. This is why I love Pittsburgh. So most people would say on the surface, wait, Cleveland was -10 last week. Now it's Pittsburgh running 6. That's 16 points just for Ben and TJ Watt. That's way too much. Give us the Browns. And they would think that they would be sharp when they said that. Well, we told you last week right here on this program that Pittsburgh should have been -2 on a neutral field. So -1 in Cleveland. It was Cleveland -10. We covered easily. Pittsburgh even had a two-point conversion to tie the game. All right, so easy win for us. Now, we said last week that Vegas was telling you pretty much that Ben was worth 5. So if you move it back to a neutral field, that's back to Pittsburgh -2, plus 1 for home, gives them 3. You put 5 for the old fat guy in. Now it's Pittsburgh -8, and we're only laying 6. So instant sharp value for us on Pittsburgh. And then you factor in, like you just said, their head coach and play callers out. It's got to move it at least 1 point to 9, maybe even 10, I would think. It should be Pittsburgh -10. We're only laying 6. I mean, it's a fucking slam dunk. Let's go fucking Pittsburgh.
Yeah, Bo Cephas, we had this discussion, and I told you that you cannot throw that many numbers and math at me, and you promised me that you would not do that, and I just got lost. I just got lost in all of those numbers. But bottom line, we're both on Pittsburgh, so I love it.
That's right, baby. And then with that was all them wins that were coming in the air tonight, baby!
Well, I'll be
All right, boys and girls, that's time you've all been waiting for. It's time for that NFL free. I said free pick of the week, baby.
Yep, and obviously we got a short slate this week, so we got to be careful with the free picks on the straight side. So I'm going to give out a teaser here for the free pick, and our NFL free pick of the week is going to be a teaser on Tampa Bay down to -2. And Bo Cephas, you can check the numbers and make sure I'm right here. Tampa Bay -2, and then I'm going to take Pittsburgh. It should be a pick 'em. Is that right?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so Tampa Bay -2 and Pittsburgh on a pick 'em. That is your NFL free pick of the week. Now, the money line parlay of the week. Woo! I feel good about this one, baby. It is going to be, follow me here, Buffalo, Tampa Bay, those Tennessee Titans, Pittsburgh, and then the last leg, the fifth leg, is going to be Ohio State on the money line. These are all on the money line. And this parlay pays 17-1. And I'm going to repeat it here in a second. But remember, if you get to that last leg, Ohio State on the money line, there is a tremendous hedge opportunity there. So let me repeat it for the people. Buffalo, Tampa Bay, Tennessee, Pittsburgh, and then Ohio State. Assuming that game gets to get played on time. But either way, if you get to those first four, you're sitting on a great hedge opportunity, whether it gets played Monday or later. And that is the money line parlay of the week.
Man, I fucking feel the money raining down already. Longhorn, tell them about that fabulous website one more time.
All right, you Glory Hole Seekers, that's going to wrap up another award-winning episode of the Football Glory Hole Podcast. We thank each and every one of you for tuning in. Y'all come back to the Sports Patio next week, and don't forget to subscribe and give us a 5-star rating so we can pay those bills. Hit us up on any of our social medias, and don't forget to subscribe to both our YouTube channels, The Football Glory Hole and The Degenerate with Bo Cephas and RJ Choppy. We give out free picks on our website, on our podcast, and also on our YouTube quick hits, so people stop being sports stupid and use them all. But more importantly, sign up for those premium picks at our website so that we may become partners for life. And Bo Cephas, as always, in a mostly non-sexual way. People, stop throwing away your hard-earned money on a guessing game. Let the pros do the heavy lifting. So sign up, tell a friend, and join in on the fun of watching football, drinking beer, and never pay a bookie again. Come on.
God damn it, people never pay a bookie again. Steven Tyler, take us out, baby!